This is a HeadGum Podcast.
Hey, buddy, it's Weiger. This is normally where I do the scripted intro to start the podcast, but because of the ongoing WGA strike and the SAG-AFTRA strike, no intro this week, as has been the case in past weeks. Thank you for the thumbs up. Or was that a hang loose, Mitch? What was that? Wow, Mitch is hanging loose. Very cool.
Hey, man, because the AMPTP won't negotiate, I have to hang loose.
You got no other choice.
It's the only thing I can do.
You got no other choice, man.
I hang loose. That's me to the day I die, dude. And I'm going to thumbs up to the WGA and SAG.
Wow, how about that? And a hang loose to the AMPTP?
Yeah.
Okay, got it. Okay.
They need to loosen up.
They need to loosen up. That's what it is.
They need to loosen those pockets.
Loosen the purse strings. Thank you. Anyway, the strike keeps going. You all know the issues by this point. I just wanted to, again, redirect people to entertainmentcommunity.org if you want to, a place where people are wondering how they can help out. This is a place where you can donate that provides emergency financial assistance for people in the industry displaced
also,
by the work stoppage.
You can go to birdfuck.com.
That info is also at birdfuck.com. So check it out, entertainmentcommunity.org, or you just go to birdfuck.com, and then that there's a link
there's
right
a
there
link.
At the bottom.
And also, if you do have videos of birds fucking, I don't know how much we've implemented that into the website. Emma, I'm looking at you nervously. Shaking your head no. It looks like maybe not at all.
I don't
there's
think
one
so.
GIF of birds fucking and that's it.
That's pretty good.
There's a few links, and then there's also like a little under construction GIF, which is cute. It's too
we could
like,
maybe, I think
guys
the
with
thing
hard hats.
To do is if you have a video of birds fucking, you should load it to YouTube, and then we can maybe have a section where we put the YouTube links to the birds fucking.
Okay, so that's an option. You can also just email them directly to the AMPTP subject line, hang loose.
Yeah, that's also good.
Anyway, birdfuck.com, check it out, and enjoy this week's episode, this week on Doughboys, Howlin' Rays.
Wow.
Welcome to Doughboys, the podcast about chain restaurants. I'm Nick Weiger, along with my co-host, Spamuel Chompers, the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell.
What?
That's a nod to Samuel Gompers, who founded the AFL. I'll give you a little context from this roast. Here we go. I love you guys. I've been a devoted listener for the last 5 years or so, and I express my love for the pod in two main ways. Going to your live shows when they're in my neck of the woods and periodically submitting roasts. I wanted to try out some roasts that riff on the strikes and name drop some historic labor leaders. All of these were created with nothing but love for Mitch and the show and for all the strikers. Here we go. Socialist presidential candidate Huge Cream v. Debs. Sloppy Joe Hill. I like this one. Chunked, covered, and smothered Jones. Boyardee Rockspin. And then I think we used this on the pod last week from someone else. Little Caesars Chavez. And then,
sadly, I really kind of only know the reference to the last one.
And just for the heck of it.
I'm a union man, don't get me wrong. I just don't know who the fuck these people are.
There's a lot of Eugene Debs, Mother Jones, a lot of labor leaders in history. And just for the heck of it, here's an Oppenheimer one. J. Blobbert Sloppenheimer. Mm. Much
you know, I always
Ben.
Love it when you do the roast and then you do like 10 roasts. It's great for you to just list them off.
Look, I don't pick them. The system is Amelia sends it to me and I read it on the show. Roastsmoonman@gmail.com.
Wow. What a start. Wow.
What a start.
It seems like it will make sense soon, but it seems like we like either just worked out a lot or are coming back from a funeral.
We're in distress. We're in distress, and it's related to the topic of this podcast. We're powering through it.
I was nervous about you for a minute in there, but we'll get to it in a second.
Yeah.
Embarrassing because the guest is here, but howdy ho to Spoon Nation. You know, when you got a good guest, it just is embarrassing to do that. It's bad. The show's bad.
We know the show's bad.
Yeah, I'm not trying to spiral here, but Emma, let's hit him with a drop. Let's get this all over with as fast as possible. I can't help but notice also my stomach is truly growling. My stomach is growling.
Growling.
With a W.
So the
growling.
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 Oh, man.
Growling.
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 Sounds different.
Growling.
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 My stomach's growling.
Now I know y'all be loving this shit right here.
God, this show sucks. Well.
It was in the drop.
It was in the drop. It makes it kind of a good drop, honestly. Hi to the Doughboys crew. My name is Andrew, and I'm a longtime listener, but this is the first drop I've made in a fit of inspiration after hearing this exchange on the Corner Bakery episode. I make music under the moniker Where's Your Dog Now, and I promise it sounds nothing like this drop. Thanks for all the laughs, Andrew. Thanks, Andrew.
Wow. Thanks, Andrew.
Growling. I got it right now. Growling.
Growling.
Yeah. I don't know why it was an issue back then.
This show sucks might be as much of a catchphrase of yours as howdy ho. Like you say it about once an episode. And you're not
wrong.
Yes,
my famous catchphrase, howdy ho, that I came up with.
That's where I know it from. Mitch, you have family in town.
I do. My mom and sister.
Yes.
We were in Carmel, California.
I was hoping to get to see them. I thought they were going to stop by the studio.
They're going to come. We were going to. The HeadGum parking lot is a little, it's kind of crazy.
Mm.
And I don't want my mom because I thought something bad would happen to the car. And then they left and they texted me that there was a flat tire. So I was right in a way that something bad would happen. But they'll be here to say hello for a second at the end of the day. They're off. I don't know. They're doing fucking something. Who knows? They're doing great.
Michael, we got a flat.
Hey, what does she want me to do? She knows her son is useless. I can't help in that scenario. So the AAA guy came. They're fine.
Oh, they're set.
I think they're gonna. They're helping me. Fill out my play swags. They're getting like a. They bought me a basket.
Oh, there you go.
And they bought
That's
me a little table.
I was over at that place, and I was like, man, this place needs a basket. They tie the whole living area together.
They bought me this globe that, like, if the sun hits it at night, it glows in the dark.
Wait, really?
Yeah, my mom bought it for me. You put it outside. It looks nice.
Does she think you're 8? Put some stars on the ceiling. Do you have a mobile?
She bought new diapers. I told you that.
Mitch, your family is here, and a great guest is here. This is overdue. We're very happy to finally make this happen. Writer, actor, comedian.
And we're sorry, too.
And we're sorry. Kumail Nanjiani is here. Hi, Kumail. Thanks so much for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
What a treat. I want to back it up for a second, because this has been in the works for a while. I checked that email thread, which you replied to earlier this month, and that started the process of trying to get you on Doughboys and figure out a time where it worked for everyone's schedule in 2017.
Is that right?
Six years have passed.
Wow.
That's
we
crazy.
Could have done so many different chain restaurants.
I know.
We could have bombed in front of you for 20 plus hours.
You had to feel better about the show back then. No.
That was year two, so I think we were pretty.
Yeah, sorry it's taken so long. I don't know why. It just, you know. Yeah, I've wanted to do it for a very, very long time, so thank you.
We know you want to do it, and we're very happy this worked out.
We are in distress.
We are a little bit. Okay, yes. So this conversation began in terms of what chain to cover with. You were asking about fried chicken sandwiches and what chain to cover, because you love fried chicken sandwiches.
I do. I love fried chicken sandwiches. I love fried chicken. Chicken tenders are like top five favorite foods for me.
You put tendies above a fried chicken sandwich?
I do.
Wow, okay.
It just, I don't order it because I feel like a child.
Yeah.
And well, unlike you, I'm not.
Tendies.
Yeah, tendies. Like I don't think I've ever had a chicken tender I didn't like.
Wow.
Like, even at, like, you know, when you go to, like, an amusement park or something, probably the best chicken tenders I ever ate was at a Disney, whichever one's in Orlando, Disneyland.
Okay.
Yeah.
Disney World.
Disney World. Disney World. It's the one that, I think, is there a Hercules? Is Hercules Disney? Yes.
Yes.
They had a Hercules restaurant. This was years ago.
I like that.
Just like, you know, like cool. One of those. And it was like, you know, mighty, mighty, mighty bicep chicken strips or whatever they were called.
I love it.
Best chicken strips I've ever had in my life.
Universal should counter with the Nutty Professor's Hercules chicken tender spot. I think that would be a good, first of all, there's not enough Nutty Professor stuff as is. So I think that.
You're a big Nutty Professor guy. What was your favorite part of the Nutty Professor?
I like the Klump family the most.
Okay. All right.
Funny.
Good pull.
The Klump dinner scene, of course.
Of course. Classic.
Is a blast.
Yeah.
Those movies gets a little crazy. Buddy Love reverses in age till he's a puddle of semen at one point. So it is kind of a weird take on the second one.
Yeah, and I think Larry Miller, it plays like the principal or something. He plays like he and like a hamster like has sex with him.
Oh,
like a giant
yeah,
hamster.
A hamster fucks him. Yeah, that is, this is true. Hamster.
Okay, I'm so sorry. I can't tell. Is this riffing or real?
No, this is real. This is absolutely real.
This is real?
This is real, yeah.
Wait, so you're saying in Nutty Professor 2, Larry Miller, who plays a principal, gets fucked by a giant hamster?
I believe so, unless I'm confusing.
Hold on a second. Is he a principal or is he like his boss? Or something?
That's not the point of the story. That's not the interesting part of the story.
He is high status. So that, like, I don't know, remember where what he is exactly professionally, but yeah, he's
but
high
he gets
status.
Fucked by a giant hamster, do you remember, in Trading Places?
Oh, yeah.
Gorilla, they get fucked
yeah. by
a gorilla.
Yeah, the two it's the two old boss guys.
Yeah,
right?
Is it them who gets fucked? I know it's bad guys. It's,
yeah, a bad guy.
A bad guy. But then doesn't he kind of get resigned? Doesn't he kind of at the end he's kind of like, well, it's a living sort of thing at one point.
Yeah, I think so. I think he stops fighting at some point. Isn't there one where doesn't the gorilla have his arm around him and they're like snuggling?
They're kind of snuggling. Yeah. That's what I was thinking. Yeah. Of.
This is the strangest way to reveal that the two of you are doing the Trading Places remake. This is. But you know that's how they wanted to publicize
that
it.
That clump suit ready.
It's a strike, so we're doing a bootleg version of it
right
now.
Yeah. Bootlegs are allowed.
Non-union, yeah, bootlegs are allowed.
Yeah, straight to DVD stuff is allowed.
I Googled it real quick to try and find, or binged it, and I tried to find out, and I think the Hercules restaurant at Disney World is now closed.
Yeah, I think it is closed.
That's a bummer.
I went a couple of years ago with Emily, and I was like, Emily, get ready to have the best chicken tenders you've ever had. They were like, the level of spice was good. Like, it was a little bit formidable, but still, you can still go on a roller coaster, you know?
I would not want to go on a roller coaster after this meal today.
Certainly not.
No.
I would not want to do a podcast, but here we are.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I had to stop. I had to give up my chicken sandwich.
And I took one bite. Is that what you were about to say? I took one single bite.
Yeah. While we're talking spicy, Camille, you were saying earlier that you were in a jalapeno eating contest.
Wow. Yeah, so, you know, I grew up in Pakistan. Our food is pretty spicy. I was saying Indian-Pakistani food, our food's spicy, but we have a reasonable ceiling, unlike like Thai food, where I think it's the stratosphere. You go all the way to the sky. So I was like in college, and I was like, oh, I can handle a lot of spice. So I entered a jalapeno eating contest with, you know, let's face it, a bunch of other men. Because it's such a stupid thing to do.
Yes.
And I couldn't handle it. I realized, like, my spice level is good because of where I'm from and the food I eat and stuff. But it's not really, you know, it's not competition worthy.
Can I take another wild stab here? Five of those guys kind of looked like me.
Well, the guy who won actually was Indian. He's still a friend of mine. Yeah.
Wow.
And he went outside, and I remember it was the winter. This was Iowa, and he threw up, and there was like smoke in the snow. It was like bad. It was. We were like, "This is
that's so
what
that's gnarly.
You won, but did you? What did that accomplish?" Yeah. So then I realized no more jalapeno eating contest, and I realized that my ceiling for spice is decent, but it's not, you know, award worthy.
That's, you know what? That's kind of where I am. Cause, you know, I like to say on the podcast, I'm a bit of a heat seeker. Mm. I like spicy foods, but the key is a bit of. Cause, like, I can't do the contest level stuff. And Mitch, I was definitely feeling it a bit
today.
You
were hurting today. I was surprised. You say you're a bit of a heat seeker today. You were trudging through this.
No, like, I like it at a certain threshold, but then it starts to get to, like, when it's a dare level, I'm just in distress.
So we should, we got Howlin' Rays, or does that come on later?
We'll get to it in a little bit. We can start talking about
but,
it.
He's pissed.
No. Sorry, take that out.
Steam coming off of me like a pile of vomit in Iowa.
That old thing. Emily says I should have a TV show called Sweating in Restaurants with Camille. In my normal life, I don't sweat. When I work out, I don't sweat. But if I eat spicy food, even a little bit, it's a spigot. So much. I'm like, it's awful.
Yeah.
And the worst, we had just moved to LA and we'd gotten a list of restaurants and we went to a place called Jitlada.
Oh, yeah, I love Jitlada.
LA stalwart, you know?
I think I'm being sincere when I say this. I think it's in like my top 10 favorite restaurants of all time.
It's one of the best restaurants in LA. And it's when people are like, I'm going to the city, what should I eat at? I always say Jitlada. It's a Thai restaurant, if people aren't aware.
Yeah, it's a Thai restaurant, and they have like, they do like Southern Thai, which I don't know what that means, except they have a, you know, they have a bunch of dishes that you don't see other places. But their thing is, their food's spicy. That's their thing. And I was like, I can handle spicy food. And so I got the spiciest thing, which was this, they have this thing called quackling chicken, which is amazing, but I got it extra spicy. And then I got a milkshake, a mango milkshake that you can also get spicy.
Wow.
That's... And I got that spicy. So it's this weird feeling of eating the food. It's destroying me. It's awful. And then there's a milkshake. So you think, oh, this milkshake will help, right? I had to go and sit in the car for 20 minutes to put my life back together. Like, yeah. Emily stayed in the restaurant, and I went and genuinely had to, like, pick up the pieces.
I love Jitlada. Shout out to Jazz, who is just the, like, I feel like the
what
platonic
ideal. What
I
gotta do, Jazz? Is Jazz a listener? Jazz, what I gotta do to end up on your Instagram?
I know.
I see all these people ending up on there. What I gotta do?
You look at her, it's fucking Mark Doofson's on there.
Matt Kowalik is on there. What's going on?
Get made it. What the fuck? Who are these fucking people? You gotta get on there. This is insane.
Yeah, what the fuck? I go there all the time.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Yeah.
So I've Jazz is lovely, and it always makes you feel welcome, and always makes it like it's just.
I think I did say to Jazz, I was like, I'm from the Doughboys podcast. She's like, I know.
Really?
Oh no.
I will say, when I used to be like, when I used to be on Instagram, Jazz followed me back.
Wow.
And then one time she commented on one of my pictures, handsome. I was like, how about that? I felt like $1 million.
Yeah.
Well, she's got good taste in food, at least.
So, my experience with spicy at Jitlada, my lovely wife, Natalie, is like, loves spicy. And she's like at the level of like, she'll just have the spiciest thing.
My question to you is, would she have, I know we're not getting into it, but like I said, you were trudging through. I was also looking up the definition of trudging. I was correct. You were trudging through your meal.
You weren't
meal.
Sure about what trudging meant?
I knew, but I was like, I haven't said trudging in a while. I should just like double check to make sure it is what I think it
is. He was trudging through.
You were trudging through it. Yeah. Natalie would be fine, right?
Like, you think so?
I think she'd be okay. I think she'd definitely feel it. She'd be showing something, but she'd be okay. But like, so
she's the real heat seeker.
So that she's the real heat seeker. But she, like, there's a thing at Jitlada, which is like the spicy challenge, which is like their spiciest thing. And she wanted to get it on her birthday. That's how much she loves spicy food. She did it, and she wanted it specifically with tofu because she knew that it would retain heat more. So she got like the spiciest version of the spiciest thing, and she just like kind of powered through it.
She did the spice challenge.
Yeah. And then meanwhile, like, I'm like eating something regular on there, like something normally spicy on their menu. I'm like, have to hold like ice chips in my mouth.
They do give you ice chips. Yeah. They give you like sort of frozen, like cold vegetable, like slices of carrots and stuff. Yeah.
Which is fun.
It is fun. And it's necessary for a lot of their food. I've also learned, you know, going to Thai restaurants, other ones, when I say spicy, a lot of them would be like American spicy or Thai spicy. Don't say Thai spicy because they're trying to make a point.
At Jitlada, I think it's
like crushed glass in it.
Jitlada is a place where I think that a lot of people were like, make it spicy. I think that they're like, I'm not going to even do this to this idiot.
Yes,
like they don't know what they're getting into, basically.
When I order Jitlada, I'm like, just however it comes. So
that's
you decide. And the level of spice varies, but it's always pretty high. But the food is so good that you put up with it.
Yeah, that's the thing.
And look, we talked about this beforehand. You're a person who can handle spice. You were on Hot Ones.
I was on Hot Ones.
Which is, there'll be like a new Hot Ones, and it'll be like Hot Ones with like, you know, like Jennifer Lawrence. And then there'll be a Doughboys listener. It's like, the Doughboy should be on. I'm like, it's Jennifer Lawrence.
What are you thinking?
What are you doing? You're embarrassing us.
Yeah, you can't even end up on Jazz's feed.
We can't get on Hot Ones.
No.
But I love that YouTube show. How was like the extreme spiciness, like the top level, the final, what is it called? The final dab or whatever the fuck it is.
I will say that up until like six or so, it's fine.
Yeah.
It's really not bad. And for me, it didn't go gradual. Like it was until six, it was fine. I don't remember the numbers, maybe seven. And then one was like, suddenly one was way too spicy.
Yeah.
And then it sort of stayed there. I didn't feel that it got hotter after that. I think I'd already, you know, my taste buds can do what they can do, and they'd hit their max. But it sort of flipped for me, like, on a dime, and then it stayed there. It was just super spicy all the way through.
Is that, was that last hot sauce, like, one of the hottest things? How did it compare to today, would you say?
I would say that it was pretty... It wasn't that far off from what we just ate. Because what we just ate was, like, unbearable.
Yes.
I feel like there's no... To me, there aren't levels of unbearable. I think unbearable is like, you know, it's all...
Once
you cross over into it, it's torture. And I think it was definitely just, you know, it's over the line of torture. I don't know.
Do you need to look up unbearable on your phone?
It means bad. Not good.
Unbearable.
While he's doing that, I we're going to talk about spicy a lot, and we're going to talk about fried chicken, but I do want to take a little bit of
a
tangent.
You got to be fibbing me. Oh, no, never mind.
Did you say you got to be fibbing me?
You have to be fibbing me with this. But it was the wrong word. That's what, because I looked it up. I said, not capable of being defeated. And then I actually.
Unbeatable?
It was unbeatable.
Yeah. Right. Ironically, you did just get defeated by your own thumb.
Unbearable.
I wanted to take a little tangent to ask you about, because, you know, I think you pretty famously just surprised everyone by getting jacked to play Kingo in Eternals. And I'm curious, like, from a nutrition standpoint.
I'm curious. Can I do it?
Yeah, can I do it,
no,
first of all?
No, you can't's the fucking answer.
but I'm curious, like, when you were doing that, like, what were you eating? Like, did you have, like, a caloric regimen that was, like, intense?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, I don't want to say, first of all, that what I did was healthy.
Sure.
I certainly wouldn't do it again. I did a bulk, and then I did a cut. Because
okay.
I'd found out quite a while before that I was going to do the movie, you know, so I had like a year and a half, so I had quite a bit of time. And so I did a bulk, and I gained, you know, I gained, like I would say 30 to 40 pounds. But I was eating, like, I would come home, eat a fried chicken sandwich and fries at midnight and go to bed. I was eating constantly all the time and working out a lot, too. And so I felt pretty awful. I looked pretty awful. And then, you know, I had a few months till the movie was starting, and I was like, I've made a huge mistake. So then the cut was also very intense and also not healthy, to be honest, you know? So I was.
Everything you described up to the cut sounds like the podcast, honestly.
Yeah, well, minus the working out.
Yeah. Yeah, I did mention.
Well, eating the fried chicken sandwich at midnight, that's similar to the pod.
Definitely sure. Fried chicken sandwich at midnight, and you know, and I actually gained weight for a role last year, and I did the same thing. I gained about 30 pounds.
Wow.
And I was eating five meals a day, five unhealthy meals a day.
Damn.
And it was so I would say if someone wants to get in shape, first of all, you know, only do it if you want to do it. Like, just find a way to like yourself, whatever that is, you know, whatever that takes. But I would not say,
I'm just thinking about
that
myself.
That seems like much harder than doing a bulk and a cut. What am I saying? Find a way to be comfortable in your own skin. Oh, okay. Something that nobody has ever accomplished. At least no Nanjiani ever has.
Same with the Mitchells. We're right there with you.
I would say if you want to do it, don't do a bulk and a cut. Just like, figure out how much to work out, what you want to eat, how much to eat, and then just take it slow and just slowly, you know, slowly do it rather than what I did, which was very intense, because then the cut was also, you know, it sucks to go from eating as much as you possibly can to being hungry all the time.
But it's cool that you can, well, I was going to say it's cool that you can kick Wagger's ass, but you always could. So I guess you could kick Wagger's ass even more so now than ever.
It's cool that you can knock Wagger out before he starts crying. Wait, so I'm curious, so you're bulking. Like, are you working with a nutritionist, or are you working with a trainer? Is someone just kind of like, hey, you have carte blanche to just eat this, hit this this target of calories, and you can kind of just eat whatever?
No, so I had a trainer, and he said you got to eat this much protein, and then the rest, fill it out however you want. Yeah.
So you have that much leeway. It's just a matter of just like having a shitload of calories. and protein.
Yeah, because wow. The point is just to like gain weight.
Right.
And, you know, that's not hard to do. You just want to make sure you're getting enough protein to turn into muscle. Yeah.
So it basically is like you're kind of like building up a chrysalis and then shedding it. It's like kind of that process. It's like you're like making the block of marble and then you're chiseling it down.
And then you're unwrapping the present. Yeah. It's
what is he talking about?
Look up chrysalis and let us know.
You know, I'm not even going to attempt that one because I don't know how to spell it.
I think it's a CH. I think it's one of them CH words that don't sound like a CH. It is. And I think, you know, that's what like bodybuilders do. They're sure. always like, if you see them between seasons, they're always like a lot bigger. But, and then, you know, I really, really, when I cut down, I really, you know, I know I released that fucking picture, you know, do you know how much I weighed in that picture? Do you know what picture I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know exactly.
I released
exactly what
you're
talking
about, yeah.
I can look at my lock screen.
Yeah.
Wow. How much did you weigh?
What do you think?
Well, since you're saying now I'm thinking it's probably less than I would think. So I'm gonna say 170.
I was the day that picture was taken, 149.
That's
149.
Crazy.
Yeah.
That's
so crazy.
I was right low 150s because, you know, there's only so much muscle you can gain in a year and a half.
Right.
And so it just looks, you know, it looks a certain way on camera if you're like lean enough. But I wasn't really that big. Mm. With a shirt on, you would have no idea.
Right.
That, you know, I had been starving myself for months.
In every role I think I've done in my life, I think that I get fatter over the course of production. I think it's an issue. I've talked about this wise where there's been points where I'm like, we need to write in a reason that my character has gotten bigger. Like, you know.
I had that on Silicon Valley. I remember one season because, you know, we'd shoot for like 4 or 5 months. And then there was one episode. We had to reshoot some parts of like episode one.
Yeah.
And so they cut it in. And as I was watching the episode, I could see the difference in coverage.
That's very funny.
I was like, oh, wow.
I did a movie called Other People, Wags. And I've told you this story before. But they were like,
a great movie.
They did a great job with that. They were like, we want you to shave your beard.
Yeah, you were de-bearded.
And I was like, I really didn't want to. It was shortly after Harris had died, who was a close friend, and I was felt fat and gross. And
so we're blaming that on your friend's death?
Yeah.
Sure. Why
Sorry,
not?
Harris.
He's not around anymore. I'm fat because my friend died.
Thanks a lot, Harris. Jeez. One of the worst things to come about from that thing is I got a little chubbier.
Oh, so many victims.
And they want you to shave your beard. The director wants you to shave your beard. And I was like, I don't think I can. And they came back and they're like, he wants you to. I was like, fuck. I mean, like, that was my one attempt to not do it was be like, I don't think I should. And then he was like, I want you to. And so I shaved it and I was like, that's fine. It won't be people. I'm in a scene of the movie. It'll be fine. And then I was the thumbnail, Wags,
yes.
on Netflix.
Yes.
I'm in the movie for like 30 seconds. And the thumbnail is me. I look like a fucking bullfrog. It fucking sucked.
You look great. It's just one of those things. You're self-conscious. And
yes.
I think it's a lot of bearded men I feel this way of like, you lose the beard, you feel like you've lost like a layer of protection, right? It's like kind of like when I've been a little beardier I'm relatively clean shaven now, but it's like, I feel like people are looking at you wondering how much is beard and how much is face, you know?
Yeah.
And in your case, there's a lot of face.
Yeah, you've talked about this before, that there's a lot of face. Thanks.
Wow, you started off so nice.
No.
And well, in the course nice of, way.
What a journey. Also, the way you see yourself is not how other people see you.
That's
like,
true.
We're all broken. I remember when I was really, really like, you know, cut and stuff, I remember I'd wake up in the morning, I'd look in the mirror, myself shirtless, and for a second I'd be like, oh, I look great. And I would see my body change in front of my eyes. I would see it physically change, and then I would only see the things that I didn't like about it. This happened every morning. I would look at myself, be like, whoa. And then I would literally like, you know, it would morph into...
Like, is your organ settled? Like, what was happening?
Yeah, my organ settled. I don't know. It really was like the definition would go away as I looked. So I could see like the filter that my brain was putting over my eyes, over myself. And so I always try and be aware of that. But it's, you know, it's something honestly, that, you know, I have issues with all
it's a
the time.
It's a lifelong journey, I think. It's hard, especially for a guy who has a quote unquote a lot of face.
Can I look, come on.
Yeah, I got a lot of face. Come on. I got a lot of face. It was on the fucking.
Well, listen, it's a great face. You want more of
it
that.
It's a good face. You look great.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
And then I'll say this, after I did Eternals, you know,
yeah.
For years after that, I tracked every single thing I ate and I put it into an app. If I ate a grape, I would put it into an app. If I ate an almond, I'd put it into an app for years. And I only stopped doing that last year.
Oh, shit.
And so, you know, it's certainly something that, you know, I have to be very intentional about, you know, just being comfortable and happy, because I love food so much.
Yeah.
It's my favorite thing. My favorite thing in the world to do is me and Emily go to a great restaurant, sit there for hours and eat, you know, or go out with my friends, eat at a restaurant. My family, that's how we hang out. We go out to restaurants. My mom's an amazing cook. So food is so important to me. And I realized that for years I had such a weird relationship with it. I mean, I've always had a bit of a weird relationship with it, but genuinely the last few years. And it's a fucking shame, you know?
Yeah.
It's hard. I mean, same thing here with this podcast. I was tracking stuff just recently and then I stopped. But it did feel like a lot to think of every single morsel that you're eating. It takes the enjoyment out of it, and it's too much, I think.
I think that's I think this is like amazing to hear, just because I think a lot of people, like myself included, like, you know, and kind of just like saw you in that shape and were like, oh man, that's goals. Like, he looks fantastic. He looks terrific. And then to hear that, like, that was like, even at that status, you were still not, you know, super comfortable in your own skin. It was like, oh, that's like, there isn't like a threshold you get to where you feel like, oh, okay, now I'm finished. Like, this is how I want myself to look.
Actually, while we were shooting, you know, and I was still sort of, while we were shooting Eternals, Richard Madden came to me and he was like, someday you're going to look back at this, at how you look right now, and not believe that you still thought that you weren't where you wanted to be. He's like, you're going to look back at this and it's going to blow your mind that this wasn't enough for you. And he's totally right. So now, you know, I still eat healthy, but I just sort of, you know, I'll go out a couple of times a week. I'll eat whatever I want. And then the other times I try and keep it, you know, fairly healthy. I also did find, in doing all that and doing so many weird fucking diets, I found out how food makes me feel physically. Like, I had no idea for years. So now I know if I eat like a sugary chocolate, I know the feeling it gives me.
Yeah.
And I don't mean like the sensation of, you know, I don't mean the good taste and stuff. I mean how it makes me feel like a half hour later. So I'm much more aware of that now.
That's I never realized that too. Just exercise or even just walking, getting steps in, and eating can just make you feel so much. But I'll be like, I'm in a rut, and I'm like, I've eaten terrible, and I haven't walked in forever, and it will always be the case. But I'll look back at pictures from when I was 25, and I'll look like the statue of David, Wags. I look like David, specifically.
You got a little dick.
specifically. Honestly, just
and now face ain't the only thing that's big.
Specifically, right here, I look like David, which I've argued on the podcast before, which is not a good look. I argue David is doing all right. I think David's doing okay.
He's flaccid.
He
can only judge
we're
so much.
Too hard on David. We're maybe it was cold David. The day that Michelangelo, you know, got there. It was a cold day in Rome or wherever the fuck they were.
I'm looking in the mirror sometimes and I'm saying, I wish I was David today. There's a lot of days like that for me, Wags. So lay off David for a second, would you, everybody?
You look great, man. You do.
Thank you. That's. And David looks great.
David looks great.
It's big. It's big enough.
It's big, David.
It's big.
It's huge.
Michelangelo. I thumbs up to Michelangelo for representing.
We went and saw that. I had this weird. Have you guys seen it in person?
I saw it. Yeah, he's never crossed an ocean before.
No.
You don't like flying or something? You just haven't had the opportunity?
I kind of haven't had the opportunity. I do get really anxious in enclosed spaces.
You got yelled at by a food travel guy.
I did?
Bill.
Oh, somebody feed Phil. Somebody feed Phil yelled at me.
Oh, I know Phil. He's a great guy. Yeah. Phil Rosenthal.
He came in the pod and he
yelled at Wags for not traveling. It was very funny.
It's great. Just do it.
I'll do it someday. We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
He's not going
to
do it.
We went to, I think it's the Uffizi Museum, right?
In
Florence.
Mm-hmm.
And we went in, and I don't know anything about art, right? I genuinely don't. But when you see, like, you know, the Sistine Chapel or the David, I had an emotional reaction to seeing it just because it's so beautiful that even my, like, artistically untrained eye was, like, taken aback at a real emotional reaction. And then you go to another room, and you remember this? There were, like, eight huge blocks of granite that had, like, There were like eight blocks of dick attempts, and it was all kinds of dicks, you know, innies, all different levels of.
Oh, this one says Johnny Sins. Wow. So there's a bunch of like just
no,
like
that was my point. You don't get the story now. No, it was like sort of unfinished sculptures that he had started making. And it was like a block of, it looked gorgeous because it's like a block of stone with like a face trying, like people trying to come out of it. And it all said that underneath it, the reason that he never finished it is that the benefactor, like, you know, he ran out of money to stop like funding the project. And I was like, fucking Michelangelo, after making the statue of David, couldn't get funding for
his
next project.
That's wild.
So, you know, don't feel bad about how we're doing here.
That's a great point.
Yeah.
I mean, like, the Doughboys is our Michelangelo. God damn it.
You want to take it again?
The Doughboys is our David, and I can't get my next pod project off the ground, Wags. This isn't my dating profile on my Hinge. This is one of the pictures I used. I haven't used Hinge in forever, but it's me with
that's
the statue
awesome.
Of the, it's kind of a warning
it's
shot.
It's funny to see everybody else is looking at the most gorgeous sculpture ever made, and you're facing away from it, looking at it through the screen of your tiny phone.
There it is.
It's great.
Yeah, not a lot of people liked that one for whatever reason, but, you know. Food in Italy also, Wags, you'd like it for that alone. In Florence, specifically.
I've heard this.
There's a sandwich shop in Florence. Did you know it's coming to L.A.? It's supposed to come to L.A.
Is it called, like, El Due? Is it the one that means two brothers?
I don't know. I'll look it up,
though. It was the one I was told to go to, and it's just, like, in an alley.
Yeah, that sounds right.
Il Due Fratelli?
Antico. That's the one I know.
Way off.
Did you go to Antico?
Okay,
it was Antico something.
But there's a lot of Anticos in Los Angeles, aren't there? I feel like every other Italian restaurant is another. What does that mean?
I don't know. It's a great...
It means the.
Well.
I know. I'm just, you know, opening another tab here. Wait, I do have a one more Eternals question, which is, and this is relates to food. Did you get a Kingo Happy Meal toy from McDonald's?
I got two.
Wow, I tried to get one,
it
was
random.
Like, yeah, I couldn't, and then I asked for another one. They're like kind of mad at me.
No, I got a couple. People got them for me.
Wow.
A friend of ours went and got them, specifically asked for that one, and then I got another one, and I gave it to my niece. Who's a big Kingo fan?
That's the dream. Yeah. A Happy Meal toy. Come on.
Yeah, it's pretty great.
Yeah, is he the first guest who's ever been a Happy Meal toy?
Pretty sure there was a Cruz Ramirez Happy Meal toy.
With
Costello on. Mm-hmm. How dare you?
He's pissed. Mad again.
Is this what it is? He gets mad and you have to, like, manage him?
Kinda.
It's usually, honestly, the other way around. So it's kind of flipped our dynamic today. Look, we got lots more to talk about. We'll be right back with more Doughboys.
What's up, everybody? It's your boy, the Spoon Man. Wags, you know I'm a sleepy dude.
You sure are.
And that's why I like Helix Sleep mattresses. That's right. Helix Sleep mattresses, Wags. I've been on one. Sleep on one. I love it. My mom loves it when she comes and visits, and I let her sleep in the bed.
Yes.
To be clear, Wally and Irma love it. They sleep between my legs every night. They love the bed. That's their favorite spot. It's the most comfortable mattress I've ever slept on.
And your sleep has improved, I know, Mitch.
That's true.
Helix Sleep is a premium mattress brand that provides tailored mattresses based on your unique sleep preferences. The Helix lineup includes 14 unique mattresses, including a collection of luxury models, a mattress for big and tall sleepers, and even a mattress made just for kids.
That's right, Wikes. So how will you know which Helix mattress works best for you and your body? You take the Helix Sleep Quiz, and you find your perfect mattress in under 2 minutes. Wags,
wow.
I did it. I finished a quiz in under 2 minutes, which I've never done in my life. But this one, there was no passing on this. It just told you what you preferred, and it worked.
And your personalized mattress is shipped straight to your door free of charge.
That's right.
Helix knows there's no better way to test out a new mattress than by sleeping on it in your own home. That's why they offer a 100-night trial and a 10 to 15-year warranty to try out your new Helix mattress.
Everybody's unique and everyone sleeps differently. That's why Helix has several different mattress models to choose from, each designed for specific sleep positions and feel preferences.
Models with memory foam layers to provide optimal pressure relief if you sleep on your side. Models with more responsive foam to cradle your body for essential support in stomach and back sleeping positions.
Plus, enhanced cooling features to keep you from overheating at night. That happens to me, Wise. I don't know if it happens to you.
I'll get hot at night.
That Helix mattress keeps me ice cold, baby. And if your spine needs some extra TLC, they got you. Every Helix mattress has a hybrid design, combining individually wrapped steel coils in the base with premium foam layers on top. It's the perfect combination of comfort and support.
And Mitch, you mentioned you took the Helix Sleep Quiz, and
that's
you got
right.
matched with a Moonlight Lux mattress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's because I wanted something that felt soft-wise, like I was sleeping on a little cloud.
Not only is this mattress the best you've ever slept on, the best you'll ever sleep on, but the setup was fast and easy. Helix mattresses are delivered in a box and straight to your door for free. Plus, Helix mattresses are American-made and come with a 10 or 15-year warranty, depending on the model.
Don't want to take my word for it, Wags?
I don't.
Helix has been awarded the number one mattress picked by GQ and Wired magazine. It is even recommended by multiple leading chiropractors and doctors of sleep medicine as a go-to solution for improving your sleep.
Wow. Helix is offering up to 20% off all mattress orders and two free pillows for our listeners. Go to helixsleep.com/doughboys. This is their best offer yet, and it won't last long. With Helix, better sleep starts now.
Do it.
Welcome back to Doughboys. We're with Camille Nanjiani discussing Howlin' Rays. Now, here's the thing. Everyone has learned the word stodge from the bear, Mitch. You know about the idea of doing a stodge at a restaurant. Well, Johnny Raisone, he's a classically trained chef from L.A. He did a stodge at Husk. You guys eaten at Husk? There's one in Nashville. There's a few. It's like a big southern fine dining chain. And I've eaten there a few times. It is really good. He learned about Nashville hot chicken while doing a stodge at Husk, and then subsequently started the Howlin' Food Truck in L.A.
You gotta be fibbing me.
It's true.
I'm trying to make it a thing.
I think it's catching on.
Why, you gotta be fibbing me with all this.
I'm not fibbing you, Mitch.
You fibbing?
I'm not fibbing. I swear I'm not fibbing. You'll know when
this
I'm fibbing.
This fucking guy. Fibbing up a storm.
So we started a Howlin' Food Truck, turned that into a brick and mortar. It is famed for its super long lines. Mitch, you and I have been there together. I think we waited 2+ hours before a PWG show to get Howlin'. Do you remember that?
No, I joined you after you had done most of the work. Sounds like our Doughboys relationship in many ways. And
me and Carlson were there for a while. We were there for over 2 hours. And you showed up. And then but we had a lovely
meal.
That
was my issue. I'll say that. That my issue with Howlin' forever was... the line. I would just never wait that long.
They would tweet all the time, only 45-minute wait in Culver City or wherever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they've got two now, right?
They've got one in Chinatown and now one in Pasadena. So that's helped mitigate things a lot. The other thing is they're now also on Postmates, which is how you and I got our meal. And Mitch, did you go physically?
No, I got Postmates.
You also got
today.
Postmates. Okay.
Yeah.
So I've been in person.
Well, you ate today.
I ate it today. My mom and sister and I all ate it today, and they all have the both of them have thoughts on the restaurant, but I'll save it.
But the short of it is it's a Nashville hot chicken concept that's based in L.A. that people love and people line up around the block for.
There's
and
a little bit of a hipstery side to it.
A little bit of a hipstery side to it, sure. Franchising brands have approached them to try to like turn this into like a Dave's Hot Chicken, and they've refused. They've
Which I appreciate.
I respect that too, because they've really managed the quality control. Kumail, so you've been you came to us. You were like, I really love fried chicken sandwiches. We pitched you this place, and you were game, and you've had this before.
Yes, I have. Yes. So this may be my third time having it.
Okay, great. Yeah.
This is probably my third time having it, too. That shows you, because it's now been around for, 5 or 6 years,
it's
right?
It's been longer, maybe. Yeah, probably around 3. It's fewer than 5, I think.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I know it was before the pandemic.
Yeah, it was before the pandemic, which now is, 3 years
ago. Wait,
are
you asking how many years or how many times I've had it?
Oh, sorry, you've had it 3 as well.
I've had
you've had it 3 times.
But 3 times.
Okay.
Fewer than 5 times, I was saying. But it's been around since 2015.
That was very confusing.
It was. I'm on your side. I've had it. I think the chicken itself is fantastic.
Yeah.
I think the crisp on it is great. It travels pretty well.
It does. Yeah. Surprisingly.
Yeah.
Look, I'll just say what my mom said to just get out of the way. This is the best fried chicken I've ever had, is what she said.
Your mom said that?
She did.
And your mom's from Quincy?
Quincy, Massachusetts. Not a fried chicken hotbed, but...
What do y'all got? Like lobster rolls?
We do have some great lobster rolls. That's more...
You do have a tremendous lobster
roll. We have some great chowder. Seafood. Chowder. That's more of our thing.
Yeah.
But she's, my mom's 75 years old. She'll be mad at me for saying that. She's... 45 years old. And she's eaten a lot of hot chicken. She's eaten chicken in her day, fried chicken.
Yeah, sure.
And she doesn't have it that often because, it's not great for you, obviously, but she does love it. She's like, I used to love KFC. So she loved KFC at one point.
I think KFC's I haven't had KFC in years, but I loved KFC.
Last time I had KFC, it was hitting. But KFC can be a little bit inconsistent.
They
That's
all
a
are
young
like
brand's
that.
Issue.
I definitely had my Popeyes phase in Chicago. I went to Popeyes all the time.
I love Popeyes. I think Popeyes is pretty consistent as the big fried
chicken.
This
is another thing
my
mom said today. She was like, this sandwich is better than that Popeyes chicken sandwich, which she liked.
They're in different categories. But I agree with your mom. It's a better fried chicken sandwich than the Popeyes fried chicken sandwich. It's impressive what Popeyes can do at scale, but.
Yeah, we were just in London and Popeyes is huge there.
Is it
weirdly?
Really?
Yeah, there's a ton of That's Popeyes. Hilarious. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they really lean into the Louisiana of it.
Wow.
You know what's weird in London? Their hipster aesthetic is like what we would call, I mean, I don't know if it's okay to say it, like white trash. Like, that's what they wear, Carhartt and stuff.
Wow.
It's all.
You probably will offend a lot of our listeners specifically because that's kind of our listener base.
No, listen, I'm married to white trash. I think it's she doesn't even. That's what she called herself. So it's okay. I'm half my family is deputy.
And so that's the hipster vibe in England is kind of like that.
It's like Southern, Southern
funny.
America. Yeah, it's interesting. It's interesting. So your mom loved it and she got the sandwich.
My mom loved it. She got the sandwich. Actually, she tried the sandwich. She actually got the breast and the wing combo, Wags, which I think maybe you got. Or maybe
I got the leg and thigh.
You got the leg and
thigh. I like dark meat, but
I like white meat. I like breast. Yeah. I mean, I'm not... I'm being serious.
I know. I'm a fool. I laughed at it.
Yeah, I see why your mom got you a basket. But the chicken itself is really high quality.
It's really well cooked. It's juicy. Like, it's the kind of fry that just, locks in the moisture.
Yeah.
And even when I've had the white meat, it's still, very, very moist. And I think it's a great fry on it. You're absolutely right that it travels surprisingly well. This was my first time I've had it delivered.
I feel like a fucking loser for laughing at breast. I was like, that sucks.
No, it's fine.
That sucks.
No.
It's funny.
It's charming.
It's
funny. It's
funny.
Yeah. Oh. All right. You were already laughing when I said I prefer white meat. I don't know what was going on in your head with that. If you were anticipating me saying breast or if you just said the word breast to yourself in your head before I said it. I don't know what that was.
Yeah, it's kind of spot on.
You know our dipshit listenership. They're going to be like, man, Kumail was so funny. It was great when you said breast. I was dying. Fucking idiots who listen to this show.
I you know, I like fried chicken sandwiches. I always like to be able to, like, I don't like, this is maybe blasphemy. I don't like pickles on my fried chicken sandwich.
Interesting. I think they do a good job of cutting through here. Here's a critique. Mm-hmm. My sister said the vinegar slaw, not enough vinegar on it.
I don't love their slaw. I do think that their fries are great. I think their potato salad is really good, and I think that, and you know, maybe we'll delay our talk on the dessert, but I think their banana pudding is dynamite.
Yeah, the thing about fries is they're crinkle cut fries.
Yeah.
And I think crinkle cut fries just keep better. They travel better.
Sure.
I think my ideal fry is a shoestring, but I think that goes limp very quickly. But crinkle, you know, I think, I don't know what the physics is, but it stays crispier longer.
Mitch, what's your ideal fry?
I just don't like when he's good. I think they go limp very quickly, and then you shot your eyes over to me and back. You're a piece of shit. He did it. I'm telling you, he did it.
Yeah, shoestring fries go limp, and you put them next to a chicken breast, and then they harden right up again. They're crispy again.
What are my thoughts on shoes?
What's your ideal fry?
Honestly, maybe this is a plain old classic fry.
Interesting.
Like a McDonald's-y,
I think the McDonald's fry is maybe the perfect fry.
Sure.
If McDonald's fries are done right,
mm-hmm.
are they not the best fry?
They're great.
They're great. I really like a curly fry, but I honestly, crinkle cut, that's a contender for me. I think crinkle cuts are really consistent. And, you know, I love Del Taco. I think Shake Shack's fries are a highlight. And I think the crinkle cut fries here are dynamite.
Yeah. Curly fries are fun.
Yeah, curly fries are fun. I like waffle fries too if I'm in the mood. Steak fries can go fuck themselves. I don't like the big fat fry.
I think that we've talked about every fry too many times. We've talked about every fry.
All right, let's keep going.
No, it's just embarrassing. We've talked about every fry, but I stand by a good steak. There are steak. I think steak fries are the hardest fry to make. But if you get it right, if you make a very hard steak fry,
uh-huh. yeah, sure,
you're hard steak fry. If you make a very crispy steak fry,
okay. You were doing great earlier. What happened?
If you make a crispy steak fry,
he had one bite of hot chicken and it's come undone.
I only had one bite, and I did it, and I was so dreading doing it, which we'll talk about in a second.
Yeah.
But if you have a crispy steak fry, I think that the steak fries at Yves Rustic are very good. There's a
place. Rustic has, like, shockingly. I like their the chicken tenders and stuff they have.
They have, I mean, in the wings, we talk about the wings being some of the best wings that there are. But
yeah,
the steak fries at Yves Rustic are good. And if you can nail a steak fry, I think they can be a great fry. But almost everyone makes them poorly. There's a few places that make them good.
Well, see, when I make a fry decision, I'm going based on just, like, odds, you know?
Yeah.
Like, same with, like, fruit, you know? Like, I think certain fruits have a higher, like, hit ratio. Like, I think strawberries have some of the lowest, have the worst hit ratio. Like, every fourth strawberry is actually really good, I would say. Whereas grapes, you know, a higher percentage of grapes are good.
I agree.
Blueberries are about 50-50, I think.
Yeah. Melons is lower. Pineapple has a higher chance of being good. But lower than grape. Grape you're always going to be okay with.
Grapes are pretty consistent. You'll sometimes get like a weird, like sour one, but you can pick those out.
Yeah,
yeah, you can see them. You can see them coming at you.
Yeah.
It's not a surprise. Like, I look at a strawberry, I don't know how it's going to taste until it goes in my mouth.
I agree. I agree with that.
But a great strawberry?
Yeah, that's the thing. If it's hitting, it's, oh man.
Yeah.
It's good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I understand from that perspective, I'm not getting steak fries.
Yeah.
Yeah. And curly fries are fun. It's a funny name. It's Three Stooges-esque.
Right.
There's a lot of other reasons it's good. But
they have some sort of batter on them, right? Like
they're a little battery.
Oftentimes they're battered and seasoned. I think, like, a lot of times curly fry is like shorthand for seasoned fry. And that happens with waffle fries sometimes too.
Yeah.
Although you'll find it unseasoned curly fry.
So if you go to some Indian restaurants, like, do you guys know Badmash here? Have you been there?
Oh, yeah.
Badmash, good. So it's a thing in India, Pakistan. They call it masala fries. It's fries, and they put, like, this kind of spicy seasoning on them. They're fantastic. So if you get, if you see masala fries, get those.
Have you, there's a new place that's like a, it's like a fusion sports bar Indian food. Have you tried it?
Yeah, I've been there a few times.
It's fucking great.
Yeah, it is great.
You know what it's called?
Pija Palace.
Yes, thank you. And it's great. It's like, there's like, and there's like fries with, like, it's kind of similar thing where they'll put like.
Yeah, sure. They do. They do. It's sort of like Italian. It's basically Indian flavors in like Italian vehicles. So it's like a pizza, but with like Indian toppings on it, or it'll be pasta, but instead of the red sauce, it'll be like some Indian curry, and it's really, that's really fun. Good. Yeah.
You said Italian vehicle. He's just thinking of Mario's Kart now.
Mario's Kart? Is that what you think the game is called? Super Mario's Kart? Are you my dad? He's just thinking of Mario's Kart. That's so funny.
Mario's Kart that he drives in Mario Kart.
Yeah.
That's what you meant.
That's what I meant.
Let's talk about Halid Reyes. So here's the thing. There are a bunch of spicy levels here. There is country, which has no heat. There is mild, which I point out to you, Mitch, and I think you knew this, actually has a little bit of heat there.
Yes.
So if you go there expecting like no heat for mild...
I'm going to give you credit. You were very sweet because I put in my order and he was like, I hope your mom knows that mild has a kick.
Yeah.
And it was the perfect kick for her.
It, okay,
but, great. But it was a good warning because I did warn her. I was like, it's spicy.
Yeah.
It's not like, I wouldn't call it a normal mild. If you got mild wings at a restaurant, I think it's a spicier level than that.
You're expecting, like, a lot of people are expecting no heat with mild.
No,
that's not the case here. There's medium, and I think medium is, pretty hot. Honestly, medium is, like, a lot of places hot. There's hot, which I got for my quarter bird, and extra hot, which I've done in the past for my sandwich, and you did for your sandwich today.
I got extra hot.
And then we also got some Howlin', which, this is a bridge too far for me. But we got some Howlin' tenders to try. I've had Howlin' before. Mitch, you've had a substantial amount of Howlin'.
Okay, so this is the, I was saying this before. This is the place that kind of put me off spicy food.
Right.
Ate like 3/4 of the hottest, which at the time, I don't know if it was Howlin' or Howlin' Plus or whatever.
Yes, there's now a level above Howlin', Howlin' Plus Plus.
Me and Maddie Smith, Jack, Allison, I think a couple people were there. We were eating this, we all had bites of this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I ate, like, no one wanted it, so I ate about 3/4 of it. And the next, like, 3 days, I was on the toilet and thought I was going to die.
It was okay while you were eating it.
It was like today where I was like, oh, my God, this is hot. And I was drinking, I was drinking lemonade or whatever.
Yeah.
And it was like, oh, fuck, this is crazy. But I got through a lot of it, and I was like, it's still, at that time, I thought it tasted good. Today, I don't even know if I would consider that to taste good.
Right.
I now, because whatever, that was like probably 5 years ago, and I like just have not even gone close to back to it, except for today. I had a bite of this Halloween one today, and I might say I hated it, maybe.
I did not think that, look, I love this place. I think it's really good. I do not have fun eating the Howlin'. That is just purely an experience.
It's not, it's an experience. It's a bat. It's like a goof, you know?
Sure.
It's not really, I don't think you can really eat it. For me, extra hot, I would say, was like right over the line. Like next time, if I'm eating for fun, I would get hot. I would eat extra hot if it was night and it was the last thing I was doing today. But if I have like to be active and doing stuff, big mistake I made when I did hot ones was I had a day of press after it.
Oh wow. That,
a big mistake. Your makeup's running down my face. Yeah.
You could easily do it before Doughboys because we're going to be sweating and looking like shit even if we're not eating hot chicken.
It's true. It's just our default state. Yeah, last time I had it, I got extra hot and I got an extra hot sandwich. And I think in the context of a sandwich, like it was like tolerable, but it was, I agree with you, it was like a little bit, I didn't want it this time.
Just to back it up a little bit.
Yes,
so I think hot would be what I would get for sure.
I know it's not a competition, but he was putting you to shame with
100%.
You were handling that extra hot pretty fucking well.
No, you were handling.
I was impressed.
You were handling the extra hot sandwich better than I was handling the hot quarter bird.
Well, there was a tempest within. I maybe have a good poker face because it was quite a bit. I was okay for the first like quarter of it, and then at the halfway point, I had to get up and walk around. Did you?
Yes.
Did you see? I had to. Like,
there was. We kind of all together. We all kind of had a moment where all three of us were up, and after we all tried the Howland, basically.
Yeah.
You guys had just been eating spicy food already, anyways.
Yeah, and the Howland was spiky. Yeah.
Yeah.
It felt like a newspaper movie when everyone's just like walking around, like trying to figure out, like, what do we do? How do we break this story?
Yeah. Yeah. Spotlight Doughboys.
How do we break the story on the Doughboys? Taking them down. So, that said, I think you really just have to, it's a place you can put yourself into the danger zone if you are like, I can handle it. Don't come into Howlin' Rays with an ego if you haven't had it.
Please
like, just go in and be like, you know what? Whatever my normal hot level is, I'm going to go a notch or two down.
Yes.
And just sort of like get a baseline for how intense this heat is because it is really hot. And I think I did like my hot quarter bird. It was very tasty, but I think I probably would have liked a medium better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely will go down one or even two because sometimes I'm like, I love spicy food, but Emily was, you know, someone asked me, they're like, why? And I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't, because it's not.
I get it.
At its base level, it's not like a feeling of pleasure.
No.
Like right now I'm lightheaded and I feel hot, like my torso is hot inside. I don't know why, but I do love it.
I love it too. It's a similar.
Does
sort of
it release endorphins or something? Is that like is that a part of it? It's never made sense to me either because it's that sort of thing. If I just feel like I am, I was saying after I took that bite of the one piece of Holland, which was this big, that I'm like I'm so worried about tomorrow or the next 2 days if it's gonna feel like I'm bleeding in my butt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't want to be gross, but that's what I'm afraid. That's like
is that what happened last time? Did you bleed in your butt?
I didn't bleed in my butt, but it felt like my insides were melting, and it was fucking horrible.
Well, speaking of my family, you know, we're sort of like we were known as like the spicy eaters out of all our. My mom's food was very spicy. My mom would eat very very spicy food. When she would eat, she would have a bite of food, and she had these like tiny little green chilies that are super spicy. And she'd take a bite of food, bite of that. And then she had an ulcer, and now she can't eat spicy food at all.
Oh, my God.
And so there is a real danger. I mean, you know, the acid, it's not good for you.
No.
Yeah.
I, you know, look, we reviewed Dave's and...
How'd you guys like Dave's?
I like Dave's. I think Dave's
I like Dave's, too.
Yeah.
Dave's doesn't touch the heat of Howlin',
well,
right?
Well, that's what I was going to say, though. When we reviewed Dave's...
Oh, yeah, you burnt your butthole.
Yeah, I had the most intense thing from Dave's, and it destroyed my hole. And I ended up like having my hole looked at by like a doctor. Like I was like apologizing to a doctor.
I like the gesture of like.
You know, he kind of.
What a show.
Yeah.
It was James
like
Cameron.
A director
he was
on
like,
set.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we got to get coverage here. Then we got to move here.
Peter Jackson
really?
Used force perspective on my hole. yeah, it was like, no, I had to, and he was like, oh, okay, yeah, you know, and I had to like get some, you know, I it really.
You got a replacement hole from somebody,
I got a
right?
new hole. Yeah. I get a hole from a executed convict. Yeah.
Wait, what happened? You really went to the doctor because
I did. Yeah, I was in such pain, and
your hole hurt.
Yeah, my hole was like
he ran to the emergency room holding his ass, going, my hole, and running back and forth.
Yeah, yeah. There was a bunch of other people from Dave's also.
I mean, it was like it was a non-prescription solution, but it was the kind of thing I just reached a point. I told Nellie, I think I just got to go to urgent care. I'm so uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, have a seat. They're like, that's okay. how many days after the Dave's did you go?
This was like the next day. So
and when you were eating it, was it unbearably hot?
It was really hot. Like it was an intense heat, but
compare
it was like
it
manageable.
To that.
No, this is way hotter. And that's why it was like a little bit, you
Did
know.
Did you pour milk on your hole? Is that true or no?
Yeah, you said it's not prescription and milk isn't prescription. What was it, buddy?
Just sitting in a milk bath, like a precog in Minority Report.
Yeah, like Cleopatra and precogs.
Murder. No, it's a... It, Really was just using like some salves and balms and like, you know, creams. Like
Prep
it, H? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But it was, anyway, all, long story short, like, yes, you can absolutely damage your body with heat this intense. And I do think this place is really good. But yeah, just be forewarned. The other thing I want to talk about is the banana pudding, bitch, because I think that was really good. I think it's a great side that they have, or I'm sorry, dessert that they have here. Your mom had some commentary on
my
the banana
mom
pudding.
Said it was too granular.
Too
for
granular.
Her. Yeah, yeah.
I have my what does that mean? Because my critique of it is the opposite.
Mitch is taking his phone out.
granular means it means a lot of things. Well,
just containing grains or grain-like textures.
Yeah, yeah. It is resembling or consisting of small grains or particles, characterized by a high level of granularity.
Yeah.
she likes smooth pudding. She was saying she said smooth pudding way too many times.
That's
and I
my favorite
out.
R&B band.
I will take one more break. We'll be right back with our fork scores here on Doughboys. Mitch, you ever sit in a hot car in the summer? You know how it's always hotter than the outside?
Yeah. You know what? Every summer I am saying, I'm going to sit in a hot car. That's what I'm going to do. Get me in a hot car. I'm sitting in there.
You're tormenting yourself needlessly. Mm-hmm. And you know what? That same logic about it being hotter inside than it is outside applies to your butt.
Oh!
When it's high 90s outside, we're talking Fahrenheit, your butt is nearing triple temps. Again, talking Fahrenheit. And if that booty ain't clean, well, you've got some mesquite marinade cooking.
Hello, Tushy Bidet gives you that shower fresh, ultra clean feeling any time of day, Wags. The climate between your cheeks is about to get capital M muggy, swamp ass, plus dry TP don't mix, resulting in shreds of toilet paper all up in your business. Avoid that sticky sitch by switching to Hello Tushy Bidet. Wags, I got a Hello Tushy Bidet, and it's cleaning me out this summer. I feel nice and fresh down there.
Wow. Mitch, I'm also a bidet convert. Hello Tushy Bidet cleans your bum 2 times better than wiping and prevents poo particles from spreading to your hands and everything you touch. It attaches to your existing toilet, requires no electricity or additional plumbing, and cuts toilet paper use by 80%. Hello Tushy Bidet pays for itself in a few months with toilet paper savings alone, Mitch.
Wow. Wags, and every Hello Tushy Bidet attachment comes with a 60-day risk-free guarantee and a 12-month warranty. Wow.
Wow. With over 100,000 five-star reviews, see why millions of people already love Hello Tushy. Go to hellotushy.com/doughboys and use promo code Doughboys to get 10% off, plus free shipping on your first bidet order.
That's hellotushy.com/doughboys for 10% off. Do it.
Welcome back to Doughboys. It's time for our fork scores. So, Kumail, here's how this will work. We will
each go around.
Yeah, please.
Do we say anything about the dessert?
Yeah, we talked about the banana pudding a little bit, but did you have a comment
you
wanted to
add? I have something to add.
Yeah, please. Okay.
I feel it was missing texture.
Missing texture?
Yeah. I like, you know, I like when the Nilla wafers or whatever are in there aren't fully, like, melty. I like a little, like, you know, contrast in textures. Like, ideally, a banana pudding would, like, to me, I like a fresh banana pudding because then the cookies are, like, kind of a little bit crispy, and I like that because pudding is so puddingy.
I'm with you. I'm very in the middle where I don't want them too soft. I don't want them like, I don't want them fully hard.
But you
want
to feel them in your mouth.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Okay. This was all. This was all.
I'm a fucking idiot. I'm as dumb as our listeners. It's bad. My mom and sister are here too. It's distracting. They came in. We talked about them. They came to the fucking door, and she thought it was too granular, which maybe is a part of it being kind of a big sog. It maybe needed more texture.
That's how I feel, but I also am like a big texture fan in desserts. Like, give me a bunch of different, you know, things.
That's a you know, Ben. We've talked about it, but Ben and Jerry. I forget which one is which, but one of the two of them has anosmia. He can't. He has
which
no sense
got,
of smell.
Which one got killed by the tiger? Sorry.
So one of Ben and Jerry has anosmia, and he can't smell, so like he has a very muted sense of taste, and so like he's
probably the one that got killed by the tiger.
Couldn't smell them coming. So he had a, so like, that's why there's so many mix-ins in Ben and Jerry's flavors, is because it's like he's responds so much more to texture.
Yeah.
But anyway, but yes, texture is absolutely key in dessert. That's a fair point.
I think I told this story before, but I took mushrooms with Harris at one point, which like, whatever, back in the day, and which mushrooms can be just a fun, you know, a fun experience or whatever. It's off, obviously weird because of how he passed away and everything like that. But we took some mushrooms and we went back to his house, and he's like, "I want to put on a fish concert," and he put on.
He did love fish.
He loved fish. He really loved fish. He's like, "I'm gonna put on a fish concert." He put on a fish concert, and he was like, and we were watching it. It was crazy, and I was like. "Do like Ben and Jerry come out at some point?" And he got all excited, and he fast forwarded the video. And at one point, Ben and Jerry like run out, and they sing a part of a song in the concert.
God.
So Ben and Jerry did come out, and it was great. It was great. I mean, he was so, it was the funniest thing I'd ever seen.
That's amazing. Yeah.
They sing a verse during one of the fish. Those concerts are weird. I don't know. He loved them.
I can't remember if you told the story of the pod before, but yeah, it is amazing.
Yeah, I probably did.
Ourselves
all the time.
So here's how this will work. We'll each go around. We'll give a closing argument, if you will, on this chain Howlin' Rays, and then we will end that by giving a fork score from 0 to 5 forks. So, final argument, your fork score, Kumail, you're our guest. We'll begin with you.
I mean, you know, fried chicken sandwiches are among my favorite things. Chicken strips for me is a top 5 food. I said this earlier. And, you know, I don't even judge a place by its fries because I'm generally very disappointed. I thought their fries were great. It was a nice bonus. I thought the banana pudding, which is one of my, you know, I love banana pudding. The flavor was good. Texture was lacking. But I think the sandwich is kind of, you know, unimpeachable. I can't do it. Oh God. So I'm gonna give it 4 out of 5 forks.
Four forks. Very good score.
Good score.
All right, Spoon Man.
I'm gonna look up unimpeachable quickly, but okay.
It means good.
I'm looking at the Mushroom Kingdom wiki right now. That's because I was looking up Mario's Kart earlier.
And then you told a story about mushrooms. Really?
Dude.
Mario's Kart.
This show sometimes as best is like a herald.
Life is a herald, after
Life
all.
Is a herald.
Life is a herald. We're in the third beat of the podcast, if you will.
Well, it's ending?
Yeah.
Didn't get paid that well from Harold, I'll say that much. I really love this place. It did put me off spicy food for life. That was like a changing, and I told you when I did the one chip challenge, that was like another time where I was like, this isn't fun hot.
Right.
It's not fun heat the way that when I was younger and I was eating hot peppers. And like you were saying, just peppers keep, it's that crazy thing of peppers keep getting hotter and they keep developing new peppers that
are
hotter.
They do. I think the newest one is Carolina Reaper is the newest one that just came out. Before that was Scorpion. Before that was Ghost Peppers.
I can't handle those. I can't hang with those. And I'm a mild boy now, Wags. That's it. I'm fine with that. And I think when you get the mild sandwich at Howlin' Rays, it is one of the best Nashville hot chicken sandwiches that there is. My mom and sister both gave it 5 forks.
Wow.
And you got to be fibbing me, Wags. I think I'm a third 5 forker.
Wow.
Five forks. Went all the way.
My only detraction I think the sides are good. We didn't talk about, like, the potato salad is good. I think you're right that the slaw is more just on the sandwich, and it doesn't really work as a side, but they offer it as a side.
Right.
And to me, it's like, if you're going to get the slaw, if you want more slaw in your sandwich, use it that way. But I don't really think it works as much as a side.
We had the same experience at Do Right Donuts in Chicago, which also does chicken sandwiches, and they had a side of the slaw. And, yeah, just absent the context of being on the sandwich, it just had nothing to it.
Yeah. I think the pickles are great. Mm-hmm. You don't like pickles, but the pickles on the sandwich and on the side, I think they work because they're pickles. You can add more to your sandwich. The potato salad to me right now is the only side that really works. There was a third side, right? Or no?
Potato salad.
Was there collard greens?
We didn't get the collard greens.
We didn't get the
collard greens. We ordered them. They didn't come.
Okay. All right. But that, I don't know if I've ever tried them. They're going to add mac and cheese. But to me, the potato salad is like the – and the fries, I guess, are the only two sides that kind of work. It's good. It's really good. It's really good. I was going to maybe deduct points for the heat level when it's hot. It's like inedible to me. It's not fun. But just know that going in. And they do warn you. They do tell you, like, it's tough.
They really do warn you. It's all over the –
Yeah. Having stood in a line for this place and waited like the duration you would for like a Disneyland ride, you have like the expectations at that point of like you kind of are cued to be like, this better be good, this better live up to the hype.
Yeah.
And my experience with Howlin' Rays is that it absolutely does. Like I did not get the end of the line and be like, well, that was a, what the fuck did I wait 2 hours for? I was like, oh wow, this is great. I get why people are cued up here. We went to, Mitch, we reviewed Hattie B's when we were in Nashville. Now, Hattie B's is not the place that invented Nashville hot chicken. It is like their chain version of a Nashville hot chicken place. But I think Howlin' Rays is strictly better than Hattie B's.
Wow.
And Hattie B's is in Nashville. This is an LA interpretation of a Nashville dish. But I think it's just a better quality chicken they have here.
The chef was inspired by Hattie B's and Nashville
hot
chicken.
Yes, and spent time in, well, I don't know about Hattie B's specifically, because I honestly don't know how old Hattie B's is. Like, again, Hattie B's didn't invent it.
And we got to give him a shout out. He may have been inspired by the Harold, because Wags, he started a restaurant right on the Franklin Strip. This is true.
Jesus Christ.
Well, I mean, my anecdote isn't 100% true.
He was inspired by the Harold, the improv form. Because he started a restaurant on the Franklin Strip, the same neighborhood as the Upright Citizens Brigade Theater.
But
that's
yes,
the logic wait, you want
that,
us to follow.
That's where Howlin' Rays is?
He was the chef at La Poubelle.
Oh, that's a strong argument. It has to be the one specific improv form that inspired his chicken sandwich. There could be no other explanation.
Train of thought was like a winding like a Mario Kart course. Looping like Rainbow Road.
He was on the Franklin Strip.
He was on the Franklin
We've
Strip.
We've all been on the Franklin Strip.
He was in La Poubelle. I didn't know that.
He was La Poubelle chef. Yeah.
Yeah.
So all that said, I think it does a fantastic version of this dish. I think everything is really high quality. I love that they haven't scaled up too much. I love that they really took their time to open the second location and offer delivery. I think it absolutely lives up to the hype. I think you can
the opposite of like seeing that. I love Dave's hot chicken, but seeing how Dave's is like now it's nationwide,
big chain. Yeah,
it's a big chain, and it's taken a hit, I would say.
It ducks in quality a little bit by necessity.
I think the quality of chicken is so important. I think it's more important than quality of beef in a burger because you really feel the texture of it. Mm-hmm. And so bad chicken can really sink a meal. And here, the quality of the chicken is so good.
It's really good.
And for me, for all those reasons, again, you can sabotage yourself. Just be careful if you haven't ordered from here before. But I think just the quality of food is so high, and I think they execute what they're trying to do so effectively that I think this is a five-fork chain. I'm going to go with the spoon, man. Wow. I'm going to go with the Mitchell mom and sister. I think this is five forks.
You got to be fibbing me.
Wow. No, I'm not fibbing you, Mitch. I'm not fibbing you.
Well, I feel like an asshole. I'm the
no, you're great.
Withholding father with only four forks.
It's still in the Golden Plate Club, which is a place of honor, and I think this is an appropriate place for Howlin' Rays to reside. So congratulations, Howlin' Rays. Welcome to the Golden Plate Club.
Not the Platinum Plate Club.
I know.
Kumail ruined that.
Oh, my God. That would have been if I'd given it a five.
You give it a five, yeah. But Golden is still really good.
I can't think of, to be fair, many fast food like chains that I would give a five to. I could maybe think of one right now.
What's that?
Oh, yeah. What is it?
Potbelly. Do you guys know Potbelly?
Oh, yeah. I know Potbelly.
Yeah.
Like, you know, because I was in Chicago for many years, and we were just there a couple weeks ago, and we ate it, and it is exactly the same as it was back then.
We haven't done it. We did it with Colts, didn't we? Colt Cabana?
I think Colt Cabana, yes. What helped us review Potbelly.
Because
he lives in Chicago.
And now there's none left in California, or at least in this neck of the woods.
Well, there weren't any ever here.
There was one that we drove like an hour, sadly.
One?
Yeah, that was like an hour. It was like near Anaheim, was it, Wags?
It was near Anaheim.
Yeah. Potbelly's great, we did enjoy everything we had there. This to me, I'll tell you, my mom and sister were both like, make this nationwide. They want that, and I'm like, I don't know if you could do it. I don't know if you could do it with Howlin' Rays.
When you scale up,
it feels like it won't reach that quality. I also didn't know if my mom was going to give it five forks because she was very confused by the piece of bread under the.
Well, that's a big move. In Chicago, if you went to like a fried chicken place, you'd always get white bread and then chicken on top. Used to go to this one called J&J on the South Side. It was fantastic.
She was confused by it, and she didn't like it.
The grease soaks into the bread. It's great.
But why is it here? She kept saying that over and over again.
Michael, the bread's superfluous.
Look it up. He's like, it means like very fluid.
Golden Plate Club for Howlin' Rays. It's time for a segment. Hey, we've got our version of the one gotta go meme, Mitch.
Wow.
I'll give you a selection of four items and we'll each decide which one is out. It's a single item must be banished, brand edition, aka a single item must be brandished. This is courtesy of our associate producer, Amelia Marino. So Emma is going to, I think, put up on the screen visual versions of each of these. All right, the first category is canned
foods. A very busy man, and we will waste your time in the worst way now. Here we go. Okay. Here it is.
Which of these got to go?
Which of these got to go? Our options are Goya, Del Monte, Green Giant, and Dole.
But the products, not the companies, right?
I think we're talking about I just have the name of the company listed here, so I think it's just the entire lineup of canned goods from this particular brand.
All right, well, I know what I would do.
I got to say the Goya look like little rabbit turds. So for me, that is the one I would maybe...
Those black beans are great, though. Yeah,
they are like, very good, but on the can, they look like turds.
I think Del Monte and Green Giant are redundant, and I think Del Monte lacks a mascot who is Zaddy. So I'm going to say Del Monte, get out of here.
Wow, okay. Well, I mean, can't kick out Dole. Dole's awesome, so I got to kick... Green Giant, which is what I was going to kick out anyway.
Do you think that? Oh, you're gonna boot Green Giant?
Yeah.
My question is, does he have a David sized dick down there, or is it like a cucumber? It's green.
It's gotta be
certainly
at least the size of those cut green beans, right?
Look at
the smile on his face. Although that's a pretty high like leaf outfit.
It's true. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm thinking Mitch could do his mocap.
All right.
Next one is chips. We got Lay's, Ruffles, Zaps, and Cape Cod.
Oh, come on. You don't get rid of Cape Cod, you fuck.
I'm not going to get rid of Cape Cod, though. I do really like all of these, but I think I got to get rid of Lay's because I think if I've got to pick either Lay's or Ruffles, and the other two are so distinct. So I say Lay's must be banished.
Ruffles have ridges, but they're getting the fuck out of here. I'm banishing Ruffles.
How dare you?
I got to get rid of Zaps.
Wow.
I love Cape Cod. I think those chips are fantastic.
Yes.
This is huge for me. Sorry.
He's invested.
Zaps are good. I do like Zaps.
I like Zaps.
They are specific.
A lot. Yeah.
All right. Next one. Crackers. We got Triscuit, Wheat Thins, Club, and Ritz.
Wow. Okay.
Man, the Ritz and Club are, I'm kind of like Ritz kicks Club's ass, right?
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
Boy, this is tough.
But then Triscuit's just such a... I go on Club. Club's got to go.
Okay.
Here's the thing about Club. If you got yourself like a classic block of cheese and you're cutting it yourself some like lengthwise, you're going down, you're cutting... They fit perfectly onto a Club cracker.
Right. Ritz, you don't get round cheese.
No.
So it's a bad match.
But
okay.
The Ritz are really tasty. Like, I like how buttery they are.
You can eat Ritz their own. I would get rid of the... I'm getting rid of the Triscuit because I think Wheat Thins is one of the perfect little snacks.
I like Wheat Thins quite a bit.
Hey, speaking of Wheat Thins, we brought up Harris Whittles a couple of times. His joke.
Yeah.
It's Wheat Thins. Give me Wheat Thicks. Give me that wheat.
Give me that wheat. So we can't kick out Wheat Thins.
Yeah. Wheat Thins got to stay. Triscuit, yeah. I can see Triscuit going too.
Yeah, Triscuit's gone.
I think I get rid of Club. Reluctantly. It's tough. There's no... Amelia keeps you on your toes here. Because we start off with brands. And now we've got like multiple Nabisco ones.
Yeah.
Like now we're getting to specific crackers. This is tricky. I think Club's got to go. All right, next one. Or must be banished. Next one is cakes.
Brandish.
We've got
Hostess,
Betty Crocker, Pillsbury, and Entenmann. So again, we're back to brands.
This is fucking hard.
This is tough.
I love Betty Crocker. I love Entenmann's. I think of these, Hostess, just I think objectively are the lowest quality, like of product. Those cinnamon rolls are badass.
You know what? I think you maybe have won me over on this argument.
I think just the quality of, you know, just the quality of ingredients, whatever it is, mouthfeel. I get rid of Hostess Ho-Hos. Yeah, Hostess.
This is so tough.
It's just hard for me to get rid of the Pillsbury Doughboy.
Yes, because we are the Doughboys.
Yeah.
And he's more successful than us. So we'll feel bitter.
I can't get rid of Entenmann's. I'm gonna go Hostess too. It breaks my heart. It's maybe the hardest thing I've ever had to do on this podcast.
It's a tough one. I guess I reluctantly go Hostess as well. It's just ugh.
Look at that.
But the other stuff is just better. I think the other stuff is just a better tier of quality. The only thing, it is nice to have a trashy option. You know what? I might nix Entenmann's. I love Entenmann's, but honestly, like having the Hostess, the thing about the Hostess is you can pick up like an individual one as a snack cake, like at a 7-Eleven. All right, next one. Next one is breakfast cereal. All right, we got Cheerios, Chex, Frosted Flakes, and Life.
Well, it's either between Life and Chex. This is very easy for me.
Yeah.
I couldn't lose Cheerios because of Honey Nut Cheerios. I love Honey Nut Cheerios, and so I can't get rid of Cheerios.
I agree there. I think Life, get the fuck out of here.
I think Life goes, even though I'm not a cereal guy, I have had all of these, and yeah.
What's your typical breakfast?
Well, I said I'm not a cereal guy, but I have this like protein cereal that almost every day. And then there are these protein waffles. I could say the name of the company, Viking Waffles.
They're
really good. And then the cereal is called Magic Spoon.
Oh, yeah. We know Magic Spoon.
Get Magic Spoon through Doughboys. Code Doughboys.
Yeah.
That it?
We'll dub in the right code.
All right. We'll dub in the right code.
So Life, because I do like the texture a little bit.
I'm going Life too. Yeah. Life is gone.
You ever play the board game Life?
Yeah.
It's a hoot.
Is it?
I love it.
I think I'd get rid of that too. Get rid of Life, the board game, and the cereal.
Oh, all right.
What about the movie Life with Martin Lawrence and Eddie Murphy?
That you keep.
It's funny, but it's also kind of sad. It's like,
that's right.
They go to jail for
life.
All right, next one.
I almost Googled that one, too, but...
Chocolate.
Okay.
All right, we got Nestle, Hershey's, Cadbury, and Ghirardelli.
This is very easy for me. Yeah. I'm going to kick out Hershey's. I know you know, but I think Cadbury... Like, I think this is a... Like, American, most basic American supermarket candy bars are just not as good as basic supermarket British candy bars.
Yeah.
I think the quality is better. I think they're smoother. I love crunch. So for me, it's Hershey's. I don't like Hershey's.
I will say Hershey's can ride the Hershey's highway out of here. I don't fucking need them. I think that I agree with you. I have not had, you know, I've not been to the UK, but I've had British chocolates and I've had Canadian chocolates, which are, you know, akin to UK chocolate. It's just a better quality. Hershey's is fucking
I have high. A huge chocolate drawer at home and I almost have finished my Cadbury. I have Cadbury Whole Nut, which is just dairy milk with hazelnuts in it. I think hazelnut and chocolate is such a great combination.
Ghirardelli is good. Crunch is my other one where I'm not so sure about, but I'm going to join you guys. Hershey's has to take the ride down the Hershey Highway, like Wyke said. It's
I do
gone.
Like Hershey's cookies and cream. I think that's a good candy bar.
That is a good candy bar.
It's gone.
All right, next one.
Vanished.
Condiments. We got
on.
So here's the thing. This is a brand thing again. Even though we see one mayo, one mustard, and two ketchups, don't think about mayo, mustard, and ketchup. Just think of them as condiment brands. Hellman's, aka Best Foods, French's, Hunt's, and Heinz.
Hunt's is out of here.
I think Hunt's is gone.
Hunt's is fucking gone.
I think Hunt's is gone.
This is the easiest one. This is a layup.
Yeah.
I mean, right?
Well, because also you can't replace Hellman's / Best Foods with any. I think French's might do a mayo, but honestly, I'm not sure.
Hunt's needs to fucking go.
I will say I've had Heinz mustard, yellow mustard, and that's a pretty good mustard.
We should have Ketchustard in here. We tried a new thing called Ketchustard.
Ketchustard is good. Someone said the guy who makes Ketchustard sent us Ketchustard, and we're like, all right, we'll try this fucking thing. And then I was like, fuck, this is good.
That's
good.
Real?
It's
that
real.
Was a Mr. Show sketch.
It was.
Yeah. It's real now.
Yeah. Mayo stirred. Yeah,
mustard
ANA. Yeah,
it's in the closet in here. If you want to take it, you can have the bottle.
That's okay.
All right, Emma, let's do one more. Let's do the next one.
I mean, this is it's riveting, as you see.
Yeah, this is good stuff. This is the podcast gets.
Butter! I like
let's
butter.
Do butter. All right, here we go. We got Lando Lakes, Kerrygold, Smart
Get
Balance, and Organic
Valley. Get the
fuck out of
here, Smart Balance.
What the fuck is Smart Balance? Don't waste my time, Smart Balance. I'm having butter. I want your fucking smart ass.
Kerrygold is a high-quality butter.
Hell yes.
Kerrygold is so good.
You gotta be fibbing me.
Yeah. Smart Balance, you gotta be fibbing me. Get the fib out of here.
All right, Smart Balance is right in the Hershey's Highway. That was a...
are we done?
I mean, we gotta ask.
Yeah, we gotta ask you a question before you go.
Go for it.
Right, that was a single item must be brandished. It's just like a restaurant with all your feedback. Let's open up the feedback. And today we have an email from Matt. Matt writes, years back there was a salsa commercial where the actor was washing out a salsa jar at the sink, and instead of dumping out the water, the actor drank the salsa waste directly out of the jar. Ugh. That commercial grossed me out so bad that I didn't eat salsa for several years. Has there ever been a food commercial or ad that this was a real ad? Sounds insane. Has there ever been a food commercial or ad that was so bad it dissuaded you from buying the product?
Ooh,
I'm trying to think. I'm going through my mental. I feel like every time I see any sort of food ad, it just makes me want to eat it. Like my brain doesn't quite operate in the way of like, oh, that's disgusting. I don't eat that shit.
If I just saw an ad that was just the name of the product and a picture, it makes me want to do it. I don't need don't even sell it to me. Just show it to me.
Yeah.
Our friend Joel Boyd Mitch was on the podcast and had he was in a ranch dressing commercial where he was like sipping ranch with a straw. And ooh, like that made me be like, I'm gonna sip some ranch dressing with a straw.
That made you want it?
I don't know. It's like it definitely made me crave the
you
dressing.
Gotta get a
yeah.
thick straw.
Yeah.
The Doughboys like double straw. Ad reads make me not want to sign up for the Doughboys on Patreon. There was just an example of this, and I can't think of what it is. There was an ad that's like, this makes me hate this product, and I don't know what it was. So that's not helpful, but I know that there was one recently.
I remember when I was a kid, there was like a special, and it was like some infotainment, like edutainment kids thing, where it was a guy talking about like commercials aren't real. Like that was basically it. And
Emily loved that show.
Okay,
that was a show. It was called... She talks about it all the time.
Yeah, I can't remember what the hell it was, but I remember liking the host, and I remember like there was a thing he showed where he was like, here's how they do a cereal commercial, and he put they used glue instead of milk.
Emily told me about this. She's told me about this.
And I did remember finding that revolting and being like, I don't want fucking glue in my fucking cereal.
Well, so mine is a weird one.
Yeah.
It really is. So, you know, my name is Kamel, and which was not a common name even in Karachi, Pakistan, where I grew up. And I was the only Kamel I'd ever met. And I always, you know, I liked my name. But when I hit about the sixth grade, there was a new product that came on the market. It was called Kamel, spelled very differently, C-O-M-M-C-O-M-E-L-L-E. And it was a condensed milk. And their jingle was in Urdu, but it would translate to thick, sweet, creamy milk. And so kids started yelling at me for my thick, sweet, creamy milk, starting in the sixth grade. And the commercial for it was one of the most sexually suggestive commercials I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And I actually have it. I could play the sound of it.
Yeah.
If you want to hear it.
Let me watch. Yeah. Also, by the way, just quickly, Nick.
I can find it if you want.
I know that I know that the Bud Light commercials turned you off of the product Bud Light for a while too. So Nick really turned his back on Bud Light after that.
I have this. Who do I send it to?
I got it.
You got it?
Yep.
All right, Emma brought
it up.
Okay,
so let's watch this and listen to it, and you'll see why it's suggestive and why it ruined my life. But it'll be in Urdu, so you won't understand what they're saying.
Could be tempting, though could be sweet. Your life, hey, your treat.
That's
Kamel, Kamel, Kamel. Amazing, hey.
Jesus.
This woman is really licking this creamy substance.
That's insane.
They are just drizzling it everywhere.
Kamel, Kamel, Kamel. Amazing, hey.
Wow.
She like puts it on her finger and licks it. And it looks. People can't see it at home. It's jizz.
Yeah, that's... just fucking Peter North was off camera just doing work.
That's your second male porn star reference.
So you did like an era specific reference. You named like an older,
yeah. Well, yeah,
like a vintage porn star. Yeah. That is good work. That's... wow. Look,
he comes up on the podcast.
He could keep going probably for a while. I was, everyone called me Messy Marvin as a boy. I was called Messy Marvin
did
because
they really?
Yeah, because of because I looked like Messy Marvin, but then also
who's Messy Marvin?
Messy Marvin is a kid from he's a commercial. Hold on, I gotta look it up. Because there was also Mikey Likes It. So people always used to say to me like Mikey Likes It, which I think was Life, maybe Life cereal. But Messy Marvin was another, and I looked just like this kid, Messy Marv. Let's see if there's a commercial for it. Yeah, here it is. It's for Hershey's syrup.
Wow.
It's Peter Billingsley.
Peter Billingsley.
And I looked like Peter Billingsley as a boy. I looked just like Messy Marvin.
Wow. And so, I may just playing this off of his phone.
Yeah, I know. I did the worst version of it. But I got like everyone was just like Messy Marvin, and they just would always call me Messy Marvin. I didn't even really get what it meant.
Wow.
It's just funny when a commercial comes out and it's like, hey, that will like ruin that kid's life.
Yeah,
I know.
My uncle had a very small advertising agency in Karachi, and he cast one of my cousins, not even his son, in a butter ad. And I was so jealous of Salman. And there was a huge billboard of him like doing, because in the thing, he would like put butter on his toast, take a bite, and then like do like, you know, muscles. And there was a huge billboard of him like doing muscles right by my house. And it upset me so much.
That's fucked. Yeah, yeah. That's fucked.
I mean,
yeah.
He was, you know, I was friends with that cousin. I like that cousin. I still do. I just saw him recently. But don't be on a billboard.
I'm going to try to get a billboard for Doughboys with just me above the head going through flexing.
If you have a question or comment about the world of chain restaurants, you email us at doughboyspodcast@gmail.com or leave us a voicemail at 830-GO-DOUGH. That's 830-463-684. And you can get the Doughboys Double or weekly bonus episode by joining the Golden or Platinum Play Club at patreon.com/doughboys. Camille Nanjiani, thank you so much for being here.
Yes.
Thank you for lending us so much of your time. Thank you for putting yourself into intestinal distress for the sake of content. Do you have? I know it's a weird time to be plugging things. Do you have anything you'd like to direct people towards or mention right now?
I mean, go to the Camille commercial on YouTube. I can't really promote anything. So, go check out Holland Rays. It's in the Gold Plate Club.
Yeah.
There you go.
And support that strike, I guess.
Support the strike. Don't. Yeah. It's weird. It's hard to support a strike because you can't do things.
Yeah.
Right.
My theory that people get so into strikes is that it makes you, it allows you to be a rebel while following the rules at the same time.
That fits this guy to a T. He loves it.
I think you're talking to a WGA captain, so I get to enforce those rules. Camille, thank you so much.
Yeah,
great to have you here. And
you're
hey,
awesome.
That'll do it for this episode of Doughboys. Until next time, for the Spoon Man, Mike Mitchell, I'm Nick Weiger. Happy eating! Want to dress like the Doughboys? Of course you don't. But you will want to wear our all-new Doughboys merch. Check out our completely revamped merch line in partnership with Kinship Goods. We've got high-quality shirts, hats, aprons, totes, and much more to come. Wow! Only at doughboys.kinshipgoods.com. That's KINSHIP goods.com. Sources for the intro are in the episode description.
That was a HeadGum Podcast.